Hey guys, I just wanted to make this short introduction to explain to you guys the panel that you're about to see, and it is from the Heart of the City speaker series. It is basically a panel that has four women from the Canadian film industry. The clips that you're about to see are mainly about Anne. So for example, they talk very briefly about what they want to show in season three, as well as behind the scenes stories, such as how Corinne was casted and stuff. So they talk about the show overall, so I just thought that would be interesting to show you guys. And yeah, I hope you guys enjoy the clips and the video. Bye guys.
When Miranda and Moira came, I did an audition for them while I was doing Sweeney Todd at the Shaw Festival. And that was the beginning of my time with Anne with an E. So that is the really condensed.
We dragged her from the beautiful theater into the claws of dirty television.
One that has been made before as a series and a mini series. And what inspired you to take on Anne?
Yeah.
Is that mic working?
What was I thinking? There was a few sort of things that happened around. For a while, I've been wanting to start developing television that were Canadian stories that could sell around the world. And I've been thinking about how great the Brits and Americans are doing that. Like, I was addicted to British television. I would watch all those the Pride and Prejudice and Emma and, you know, all these, and they would remake them every few years with new actors and make them more relevant and contemporary, and I loved that. And I would devour these sort of classic dramas, and a lot of them based on books. And so I thought, why aren't we doing that in Canada? And what is our equivalent of something that could be made into a long-running television series that's a classic Canadian brand? And of course, I was driving my car and I was like, Anne of Green Gables. And had realized that although there had been a series many moons ago in the 1980s, which I knew very well because I played Josie Pye in that series when I was 13. I thought, you know, there hadn't yet been an ongoing series where you could delve into the character and slow the stories down and really get into it. So that came to mind, and so it was sort of resonating with me. Like, I think that's a good idea. Is that a good idea? Could I sell that? You know, do we want that? And then I was up at my farm with my 15-year-old nephew, and he was showing me his Instagram, and basically there was 200 girls with bikinis. That's all it was. It was like bikini. And I was like, why are all your female friends wearing bikinis? Like, do they not want to lead with books or their ideas or sports or what they're passionate about or what they think about? Why is this the first image of all of these young women? And I'm super horrified. And of course he's rolling his eyes like, I'm the aunt, you know, complaining about it. And I go, no, I get it. I'm like, you're hormones, you're 15, it's sex, it's sports, it's girls, I get it, it's beer, that's mostly what he thinks about. But I said, I respect that. And he said, there's got to be more respect for these women. Don't you care? And don't they care? And so in my mind I was like, all right, the problem is there's not enough out there in the world that is feminism that is identifiable and kind of injecting into young people, at least in my mind. Like, not so it's being told you have to, you know, believe in equality, but so that it's like part of culture and digestible in a way that young women want to feel inspired by it. So I came away from that and I'm like, Anne. I'm like, if we could take Anne and we take this classic story that people love, it's just a great, wonderful, beautiful old story, but I can inject it with some of that feminism, and are there other things we can do to make it relevant? Because it's not worth bringing back these old books if they're not going to be relevant to today's audience. So it was all those sort of ideas at once. I had been working with Moira Wally Beckett on a film, developing a film in the Arctic, and I called her up and I said, what about Anne, and what about doing a feminist angle? And she loved the idea, and I called the CBC, and that was sort of it. But it was really about, it was about looking for the right thing, but it was also about, like, what I was like feeling. And I think in general, I'm gonna toss it back to you guys now, which is, I feel that the way that I'm coming to decisions about things I want to make in the world are because it needs to feel relevant. It's not just that I want to tell it, I feel like I need to tell it for some reason.
I have a question for you. I'm going to make you guys continue to talk. One of the things that I thought was so interesting and exciting about Anne is that sort of spectacular vista and the world of PEI brought to life. But you shoot most of it here, and I
dirty little secret.
And I have heard some of the stories, the production stories, about how you have taken Ontario and turned it into PEI, and they're so fun that I'm hoping you might be able to share some of the things, the biggest challenges that you faced in turning Ontario to PEI, and just also taking a, you know, you're in a specific period of time. How did you address that with the casting, with acting, with wardrobe? Like, what are some of those production challenges?
Well, we always, from the very beginning, wanted a kind of documentary level of realism for the show. We really wanted to not have a proscenium historic show that felt distant and precious and sort of formal. We wanted to feel like, what does it really feel like to live in the 1890s, you know, in Canada? Like, where is, we wanted to be, it was dirty, it was difficult, it was hard to be on a farm, it was laborious. If you were an orphan, life sucked, you know. If you were a redheaded orphan, life really sucked. And we wanted to show that. We didn't want to be precious about it. We wanted to be kind of Dickensian and in it. So from every decision we've made, from how we shoot the show, to the costumes, to the production design, is leans into that reality that we want to feel, so that we're not outside of it, we're inside of it.
No makeup.
Talk about that.
Very funny. But we all got into the makeup trailer, and you know, they basically said, "No, that's good." I went, "I have no makeup on." That's good.
By the way, like every actress's nightmare. We had one actress that came in, and she had just spent $250 getting eyelash extensions. And we sat her down, we on camera, and the DP's like, "Can you come look at this?" And we're like, "Oh yeah." Sorry. The director had to take her aside and say, "I'm so sorry," and had to peel off her $250 extension. And she was bawling her eyes out. And I get this call from the agent, "How did you do this to my client?" And everything. And we're like, you know what? It's the 1890s. There were no extensions in the 1890s. We also, by the way, we would love to shoot more in PEI. It's very expensive. We don't have full crews there. We have managed to go there once a year, and we love the people of PEI and what we get from it. But one of our big things too is to try to make it look real. We have red roads, right, in PEI. Everyone complains, like, we don't have red roads in Ontario. So there was a lot of conversation about how to do this, and finally our production designer came up with a solution. We crushed hundreds of pounds of red brick into these like niblets, like our sort of red road niblets, and we literally carry, there's a whole greens department that carries this red road everywhere we go. So when we go to Milton to shoot a scene, or we go to Hamilton, or we go to Pickering, we bring our red road with us, and we lay it all down, and then we have to sweep it all up again and take it away, because of course if you're in Milton, they're like, excuse me, you know, get rid of the red road. And that crushing of the bricks every year, this isn't even the labor, cost $50,000 per season. Yeah.
That's crazy.
That's crazy.
And that red road comes home with you.
With all of us in all our homes, every cast member is, you know, in this costume. But you know, I think those are the little things that make a difference. We shoot the show with very high quality camera and something called 4K, which Netflix demands, which is this kind of a real, which is a HD level. I'm not technical, but it's very precise, and it picks up on everything. So it would notice, I mean, our costume department will not have a zipper. They didn't exist. They won't have a stitch. They don't want to show stitches from a machine. So everything is hand-stitched.
And I also wanted to make sure that none of the characters looked anything but authentic. So Marilla, for example, has the same belt with every costume or the same skirt. I have like two outfits and that's it. They're, you know, they recycle them because that's what it would have been like. They didn't just get to have a new blouse unless they made it, took the time away from the farm to do all that kind of thing. So that I just thought that was amazing, you know, that we all had certain costume pieces that were just for each character.
But almost everything is built. We do rent some things, but all of the costumes you see on the show, we have 11 seamstresses and a huge costume department, and they build everything from scratch, and there's an entire department that then dirties everything. After it's freshly and beautifully made, they break it down, and they dirty it, and they rub mud in it, and they, you know, sit around on it, and they wear it to wear it down, and then finally it's, you know, camera ready. What about you guys? Are there things, diversity is a big issue, and of course when the first season of Anne of Green Gables, there's a lot of white people, right? So so that was something season two, once we introduced the show, we thought, okay, we really, really, really want to reflect more of what Canada was in the 1890s, which wasn't just a bunch of white people, and let's make sure that we bring diversity into it. So we built the Bob, which was the first black community in Prince Edward Island, and we always wanted to base it in reality, so we did that research and then brought a Caribbean an actor, he's from the Caribbean, and brought him into the Bog and then into that world, which was great. And we're having even more diversity in season three that's being written right now, so it's really important to us to do that. Casting, we are the same. We cast initially on tape. Sometimes we're moving so quickly that we actually don't get to meet the actors in person. So it's a little bit instinctual, but we drive our casting director nuts because we're super picky, and if she shows, she'll see 40 people for a role, and then we'll see the final 10 picks, and if we don't like any of them, we'll just say, go back. Nope, we haven't found it. She's like, what do you mean? I've seen every actor for this. And I was like, no, there's got to be, like, I don't know if you remember in season one, there was the milkman, which was the big, roly milkman guy, and he's a wonderful actor, and we were like, no, we want him more. He's got to feel milk-fed. And he's got to be full of humor. He's got to be joyous. And it was this thing that, you know, where it was written, and we saw it. We saw him, but he kept not existing, and we just said, keep going back, and then sometimes I'll say to a casting director, well, let's be more innovative. What about, go to comedians then. Stop looking at actors. Let's go to somebody who you wouldn't think of. And that's where we eventually sort of, when she started to think outside the box. Corinne's here because, I think I'm fair to say this, this is okay. This is how, you know, we all care so much about casting. We had cast another actress to play Rachel Lynde. Well, that's public, but it's true. And I'd be careful about this. So someone else was cast, and they started shooting with us. And we shot for a day with another actor. And it was quite apparent early on to me that day, as we were watching it live happening in the moment, that we had miscast. And by the way, this is a fantastic actor who I would work with again. It just was not the right fit for the role. And there was a number of qualities we really needed in Rachel Lynde, because she had to be the humor and the contrast and a totally different energy, because so much of the show, at least in the beginning, is quite serious. Anne's serious, she's dealing with serious issues. Marilla's harsh and tough. Matthew's reserved. And so we needed that place to breathe. And if that part is also serious, then we thought, I'm young, we're going to be killed. No one's going to watch this show. We need to have that levity. And so it was really one of the hardest things I've ever done, because it's, of course, you know, if you imagine the expense, the time, you get Netflix and CBDC to sign off on these actors. You've hired someone for the entire season already. So it really was a big hit to us, but it felt like it needed to happen. And so so all of a sudden we were looking for an actor and we were scrambling because we basically had to change the entire schedule. We were shooting our pilot. We shot 28 days, which was very luxurious, but we were sort of 10 days into it, so I think we had about a week to find someone. And the blessings of the gods were that all of the theater, we wanted to go to Sean Stratford to look at actresses, but they were all working, because at the time we were shooting, it was the early fall, they were all busy. So suddenly when we went back, there were a number of these wonderful actresses that were available, and we saw a few auditions. It was like, okay, that was great, 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 great. And then in one of the takes came in, backstage, Shaw Festival, scrappy, kind of crappily shot, blah, 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 in a little chair, and there's Trent being like, ah! And like everything that we needed. I mean, it was like, she blasted off the screen with such humor and life and vitality and energy, and it was like, oh my God, that's it. And so we loved her right away, and what a blessing, right? Like, that's how it happens sometimes. And what's interesting is, within one day of those dailies, the first day, then we had to go back to the same location and reshoot, but we'd already shot Anne's side of the scenes. We actually just shot Prim, right? Yep. Yeah, we didn't have time to shoot all the other parts. She had to be able to cut you in. Netflix called me right after the dailies, and they were like, oh my God, who is she? She's incredible. And CBC was incredible. So it was also funny how that happens sometimes, right? But I'm so grateful, and you're so fantastic in the show, and you bring such life, and it's amazing, amazing. What was your experience like coming from theater to film, back to film after all those years? And what was it like to deal with the pressure, I guess, of knowing you were replacing someone?
I didn't have time to think about that. I'll be honest, it literally was, I auditioned on a Thursday, found out on a Sunday, was in Toronto on a Monday in wardrobe in a hotel Tuesday with three episodes shooting at 5 o'clock on the Wednesday. So I had no time. I was a bit scarred through it all because it was incredibly fast, quite stressful. It wasn't until the end of the week that I was going home and my brother phoned and said, how is it? I said, I can't talk to you. I think I'm actually having a heart attack. I'll call when I come down by Sunday. But seriously, it was looking back on that and now moving forward, I learned more in a week about breath, confidence, focus, joy, hell, everything, all mixed up into that whole week. It was incredible, but it was wonderful, and I'm very grateful.
And do you feel like going from theater to film is different?
Well, I was doing Sweeney Todd, so that was about as big a performance as you could get on stage to then come to camera. But Rachel is a bigger character, but I would watch Geraldine and Matthew, and I would try to be just like them. just go. Don't be like that. We already have them. Geraldine James is amazing. Her Zamorella, you know, she's like, well, Rachel, you know, she's like got her stove, like her thing going on. And then Grandma would pick up and go, what are you doing? I'm tired and you're funny and you're funny and you're hilarious and you're supposed to be the counter to that. I think you felt like, well, I'm gonna act like them.
Anyway,
and then coming into the second season, things calm down and you have a bit more breathing time. But the writing is so wonderful. The company is so wonderful. The crew were so helpful to me. One of the cameramen took pity on me the first week because I just was, at one point someone called action and I just froze. I just kind of stood there thinking, what? Why is everyone looking at me? But he was so wonderful. He helped me with my eye line, like where to look in the camera, where to look off to the side. Like it was just, everyone was so wonderful and kind. And it really is, that whole company, and the children are amazing to work with. They are all just, well, they're not children anymore.
We have some little four-year-olds. They're kind of adorable at Christmas time.
The challenges of doing a show with kids, of course, we're going into our third season, and the girls are all getting boobs, and the guys are all, like, shooting up, like, we used to be, like, you know, getting, like, don't get any bigger, and now season favorite is like, all right, you know what, this is the season of hormones and bursting out of your corsets, and on Netflix in Saudi Arabia. And how bizarre, like, what, right? And so I think, like, what? Like, that streaming does that, you know what I mean? Streaming suddenly gives us access to communities and populations as creators that we would never have thought of before. And I'm like, dang, okay, what else can I make for the Middle East? Like, is there... I'm like, are those women, like, is it, do they want to rip off the veil and be like Anne? They just want their, let their freak flag fly? I don't know. feminism with a little sugar. I don't know. I don't know what it is.
So, she is changing my life because the scripting that is coming out of her mouth, I'm sitting on my sofa. I'm like, that's me inside. She just gave me scripts. She's giving me scripts. So it does not surprise me in the least that there are girls elsewhere in the world, possibly not even girls, who look at her and just say, that is me, that's my essence. I'm getting goosebumps when I'm saying this, because she is so powerful, the casting, the rapport that I see in the cast. So, of course, that's my love fest. Thank you.
I will deliver that message to our showrunner and our seven female writers who are writing and breaking season 3 right now in LA. They will appreciate that.
When I heard that you were being part of this, I'm like, okay, I get a chance to actually talk to people who are in my living room and say sorry for me. He's been my locker when I was 16, and like, yeah, he's probably in 30 or 30.
Very, very cold. And so opening up such opportunities is really important for our community. And I have two young kids, twins, 6 years old. I got them in the business as well. But when they were two, they looked on TV and they were often looking for diversity, and they connected with the Mexican show, Dora. And when Blackish came on TV, they looked at us at 2 years old and said, "Mommy, Daddy, look, there's you and Daddy." It's that important to see representation, because now they can emulate and see and create their own stories and narratives. That to say, thank you, and I don't know what the challenges and opportunities are to see more of the inclusion of diversity. It's beautiful what's happening. I can see more opportunity. So thank you.
Don't tell us this is going to be.
I was going to say somewhere, I'll say it right now. I came into the business many, many, many years ago working, and I've been doing a lot of stuff, 10 years of background work, because I wanted to see what the process of filmmaking was and how to make it better. I see someone that I know. But I felt like I spent 10 years of not learning very much, being in background, because you're always stuck in the holding. And this summer I had the opportunity to start working as a grip on some sets, and it's just so amazing. I really respect all the artistry that goes into this whole behemoth of entertainment, because every person is a real technician. And the work that is being created, from the writers who have to write and imagine this stuff, so every craft person that has to make this happen and become reality. And now my filmmaking energies are reignited. My father is a writer, and he comes from stage, and he sent me his first script. And I have to reprogram him completely to say, this is not about what your objective is, as I'm capitalizing the time right now. It's a whole business, and these stories mean something to other people's lives. So we can't have our own personal objectives. He's a Rastafarian, wants to legalize marijuana, it's now happening in
Canada. Someone who, I don't know how to talk about it. I'm gonna get really emotional. Someone who grew up with privilege, like, I'm aware of my privilege. I am. And sometimes I feel a lot of guilt. I know that's like, I don't know if that's the thing to say, but it's this sort of feeling like I've been opportunity, and I look at people around me that don't get the same or haven't had the same opportunity, and I think it's fucked up. You know, I do. And I'm really grateful for all these movements that are happening right now, for Me Too, for Idle No More, for Black Lives Matter. And I think all we should do as people in my position is to sit back and listen. I've learned a lot in the 10 years I've been working up in the Arctic. I've been incredibly humbled working with Indigenous people over the past 10 years, and I'm still learning. And it's time to kind of sit back, a lot of us, and listen and respect the voices of others, and really like examine ourselves and keep examining ourselves, because I'm trying to listen, and I'm trying to respond, and I'm trying to do what I can. I really believe we need more diversity, so what can I do is build it. I believe we need more female writers. There's 7 writers writing Anne right now, and they're all women. And there's 3 of them are diverse, 2 Black, and 1 Indigenous. That matters to me, but it's still not enough. Like, I still think we have to do more, and it still doesn't take away from the fact that I have opportunity, and I have to keep helping others have it. So, I don't know. I'm just, thank you. It means a lot to hear you say that, and I can't, you know, I'm excited for what all these artists are bringing. That's the thing, is like everyone's so bloody talented. They should have a voice. They should have a place because they're so talented. And then there was a bunch of kids that came that couldn't get into the movie, and they were like, well, I guess that's the only opportunity I'll get to be in the film. I'm like, dude, you know what? Tell your own story. Because really, I can't wait till you don't need me anymore. That's actually really, you know, I'm already trying to do less and help others do more. So I'm getting old. I'm 50, and I'm on my downside, so it's time to time to give it to others, right? Give the platform to other people.
Well, congratulations, because you're doing a great job, and it takes just one opportunity for one person to get out of their place where they don't feel like they can get an opportunity to be playing right now, and you've done a great job, so thank you.
First thing we climb a tree, and maybe then we talk, or sit silently and listen to our thoughts.